My name is Alexey Semyanov, and we are interested in extrasynaptic signaling in the brain and regulation of synaptic transmission by extrasynaptic receptors and changes in local ionic concentrations. Our brain operates as a large neuronal network, neurons connected to each other by a specialized contact called synapses. Information arrives to synapse in the form of action potential. Action potential triggers release of neurotransmitter, which activates postsynaptic receptors of different kinds. And we are particularly interested in glutamatergic synaptic transmission, which is mediated by neurotransmitter glutamate. Synaptic transmission considered to be a key part of the signal propagation in this synaptic network, and regulation of synaptic signaling and plasticity of synaptic signaling, long-term changes in synaptic strength, considered to be mechanisms for learning and memory. Therefore, it's very important to know which cellular and molecular mechanisms are involved in the regulation of synaptic transmission. And in this particular project, we addressed one of those mechanisms, which we call changes in ionic concentration, local ionic concentration. Those changes in ionic concentration can be of any ion involved in the synaptic signaling, and in particular during synaptic transmission and generation of action potential and their propagation in axons, we have accumulation of potassium.
Hi, I'm Pei-Yu. I'm the first author of this paper. We recorded potassium currents from single astrocyte in the hippocampal slices to monitor the changes of extracellular potassium during synaptic transmission. We also performed two photon calcium imagings from presynaptic terminals of CS3 pyramidal neurons to investigate the effect of changes of potassium on presynaptic calcium dynamics and release probabilities of neurotransmitters.
Accumulation of potassium in synaptic cleft due to activation of postsynaptic NMDA receptors can increase calcium transient in presynaptic axon, and this increase in calcium transients increases probability of neurotransmitter release, in our case glutamate, for subsequent action potentials. This phenomenon is also called frequency-dependent facilitation. Frequency-dependent facilitation have never been associated with accumulation of potassium in synaptic cleft and activation of postsynaptic NMDA receptors. And this accumulation of potassium in the synaptic cleft can be viewed as a form of retrograde signaling. One interesting thing which we discovered during this study is that to reach substantial activation of potassium in the synaptic cleft, which would work as a retrograde signal, we need to unblock NMDA receptors from their physiological magnesium block. This block can be removed from the channel of NMDA receptors upon depolarization of postsynaptic neuron. And interestingly, activation of only one axon is not sufficient to remove this magnesium block. We found that we need activation of several axons which produce a significant depolarization of postsynaptic neuron, and this depolarization removes magnesium block. Therefore, this phenomenon is working on the level of network. Several synaptic inputs to one neuron or one dendritic branch activated simultaneously, then we will have retrograde signaling mediated by postsynaptic NMDA receptor. And this makes our story interesting because up to this point, frequency-dependent facilitation of the synapses have never been associated to the activity of the network. It was always thought as activity of one individual synapse. In this particular study, we studied hippocampus. This is important structure involved in the process of learning and memory. Therefore, we believe that this type of information processing in hippocampal networks might be somehow linked to process of learning and memory. However, we would not limit our study only to hippocampal glutamatergic synapses. In all synapses where NMDA receptors are present, this phenomenon in principle can take place.